a track and field enthusiast. And a reminder, Olympic track and field competition begins tomorrow from the L.A. Memorial Coliseum. Well, while you were watching the soap operas, men's sprint cycling semifinals were taking place at the Olympic Velodrome. Here's Bill Fleming.
Once again, every one of the 8,500 seats in the Olympic Velodrome is taken as we move to the semifinal round of the 1,000-meter match sprint event. The United States has two men in the semifinals, the veteran Mark Gorski of Costa Mesa, California, there on the right, and Nelson Vales of New York City. I'm Bill Fleming, and I have, quite frankly, have always thought of this as the glamour event of cycling. In fact, if you come right down to it, it's sort of like chess on wheels, because not only do you have to outmuscle your opponent, you have to outthink him too. And I think you'll see the strategy take place in this three-lap race. You don't want to lead this race until you cross the finish line, because the man who's out in front has to do all the work. The drafting takes effect. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. I think one of the questions has to be, would the United States have two men in the semifinals if the Eastern Bloc country and the Soviet Union was here? And I think Eric Heiden's in a position to answer that question.
Well, first of all, because of the boycott, every country was allowed two riders in the sprints and in some of the other competitions. Otherwise, it would have been one rider from each country. And the big thing is, in the sprints, we're missing probably the two best riders, Sergei Kopilov of the Soviet Union. Mark Gorski beat him here last year, and has since then, early this spring, had some very good rides with Kopilov. Plus, there's also Hetzlich, the undisputed, probably the best rider at the sprints that anybody has seen in a long time. And those two are missing. But Mark Gorski and Nelson Vales have really been coming on strong. They've had some good results early this spring. Gorski, I would have to say, probably right now would be battling it out with Hetzlich and Kopilov for that gold medal.
You know, Gorski himself was a member of the 1980 cycling team. It's rather interesting to talk to him about what would have happened had he gone to Moscow. Earlier, we asked him the question, and here was his answer.
I think if I had competed in Moscow in 1980, no matter what the results were, I probably would have quit cycling. But because I didn't compete there, and I thought, hey, maybe, you know, maybe I can improve. And, you know, I never really got the true Olympic experience. I think that, you know, pushed me to continue competing after, and, you know, through 84.
So it'll be Mark Gorski against Tsutomu Sakamoto of Japan. Japan has never won a cycling medal. You think he won't be inspired? Back. It's Gorski against Sakamoto in the first race in the semifinals, the best two out of three. Three laps around the velodrome, and on the inside, on the draw, Mark Gorski will be there on this in this first heat. Now, it's his obligation to lead during the first lap. And I think, Eric, it gives us an opportunity to talk about the strategy here. I mentioned chess on wheels. I don't think that's an extension too much, do you, or an exaggeration?
Not at all. These riders, not only do you have to have good strategy, good tactics, you have to have an open mind so that you can really roll with the race. Plus, you got to be strong, and that's where Gorski has a big advantage. He's probably the biggest and the strongest guy out here, probably has the fastest leg speed.
He's 195 pounds, which is a pretty big cyclist. Contrasting that with Sakamoto, who's 155 pounds. In order to get to the semifinals, Gorski defeated Leon Richardson of Antigua, Paulo Jamir of Brazil, Claudio Iannone of Argentina, and Gerhard Schiller of the Federal Republic of Germany.
Speaking of size, sometimes it's kind of nice to be a big sprinter, because you really intimidate the other riders, and a lot of times you'll see the guys going elbow to elbow, shoulder to shoulder, and when you got a lot of weight to throw around, you can move riders wherever you want them.
Now, as soon as they come by this time, they will have two laps to go, and that's when the strategy will really start. You'll see Gorski slow up. He keeps looking back at Sakamoto. He doesn't want Sakamoto to get a jump on him or a break. But in cycling, to go all out for 15, maybe 20 seconds, that is the maximum. You just simply can't go any harder than that. And so they save that for about the last 250 meters. In fact, in the match sprint, they only time the last 200 meters, and that will be the time that you'll see come up on the screen. Well, Gorski's not fooling around very much. Sometimes they'll come right to a complete standstill on the track. But these two men are watching each other very closely as they come by here this next time. There'll be one lap to go.
Watch how Mark continues to look over his left shoulder. He does that so that just in case Sakamoto drops down the track, he can jump on Sakamoto's wheel. I expect this to be a relatively easy ride for Gorski, But he's got to pay attention. You can't be too overconfident in this sport. And there goes Sakamoto.
Sakamoto down low. Now Gorski will move up there as quickly as he can into the slipstream, try to draft him, and then swing up high and slingshot home.
Oh, Gorski looks strong. Sakamoto got a good gap on him, but Gorski's too much.
Gorski wins it as Sakamoto went to the inside and off the track. So Chuck went up for Mark Gorski of the United States in 11:17 from the 200-meter mark on in. A very good time indeed. Here is the final 100 meters.
Well, Sakamoto did what he had to do. He got a good gap on Gorski, but Gorski was just too strong. Sakamoto drops to the inside of the track. Gorski just pedals right on through. You aren't supposed to go onto that apron, and the officials kind of frown on that. But every now and then, they'll let you slide.
So Gorski now needs to win one more heat to go to the finals. Sakamoto has a lot of pressure on him. As I mentioned earlier, Japan has never won a medal in Olympic cycling. And so Sakamoto will have to win the next heat. Right now, Gorski's looking... The first heat in the best two out of three in the semifinals of the 1,000-match sprint will feature Nelson Vales of the United States against Philippe Vernet of France. Now, we talked about strategy a little bit earlier, and we had an opportunity to talk with Nelson Vales about his strategy in the sprint.
I'm very versatile, so I can go from the front or the back. Person wants the front, fine, he can have the front, and he may feel like he's in control, but all times Nelson is in control. You come into two to go, the pace may begin to quicken. You know, if I'm still in the lead, I still have my eye on my opponent. And when it gets down to the final bell lap, one to go, number one priority is to stay high, keep your eye on your opponent, and roll, and do not wait for him. So when he begins to run at you at a charging rate, you begin to run from him. And you stay high as long as possible, and then you use as much of the banking, as much as the transition to your advantage, to get a good 200-meter time, and with a good 200-meter time, you'll most likely get across the line first.
And they're moving out now. Nelson Vales is on the outside. Vernet drew the inside pole on this best of two.
What a story. Still high, way up on the track. Riders have to be careful because of that 33-degree banking. There's a tendency, if you're going very slow, to catch your right pedal on that banking. It lifts up your back tire, and down you go. They'll restart the race, but you end up with a little bit of a bruise and lose your nerves sometime.
I was about to say, what a story that Nelson Vales has. He came on very strong at 83. He was the Pan American champion. He was a former messenger in New York City. Grew up in Harlem, rode a bike trying to make a few bucks a week and delivered the packages faster than anybody else, and thought, well, maybe I'll become a road racer, and did, and now he's become a really fine track cyclist. He's against one of the best of France. In fact, the French national sprint champion is Philippe Vernet, and current world tandem sprint champion with Frank Dépine. So he's in against world-class competition, and you can see that the Frenchman is very wary of Nelson Vales. He's seen him all week long. He knows how strong Vales is.
But I think Nelson also has to be concerned with the French rider. The French rider has really opened a lot of eyes. Nobody expected any French rider to do this well. But I think having Daniel Morlan as his coach has helped him a lot. It teaches you the strategy. That's one thing that these riders really have to learn, and it's one of the things, if you have a good coach, that they can teach you.
And standing on the track dead still, you have no idea what kind of balance and concentration this takes.
Nelson looks a little bit more relaxed up there. You can see he doesn't want to take the lead. He'd rather ride from behind.
You're only allowed to go backwards 5 centimeters here.
But they can sit here all day.
Right. And it's happened. You know, you spoke of Morlan of France on ABC's Wide World of Sports. A number of times he has appeared, and in the Olympic Games, too. And he was always, frankly, one of my great favorites. A tremendously powerful rider, a great gentleman, and he's here as the coach of the French team, Olympic champion in 68 and 72. Not only do you look at the concentration on the face of Nelson Vales, but did you notice the New York skyline imprinted on both sides of his safety helmet? Well, he's going to take it out now. They have two laps to go, or a little bit less than that. This is heat number one and the best two out of three in the match sprint.
Nelson looked pretty good in his two rides to get this far, and I think this is going to be a big challenge to him because of that French rider. He, like I said before, he's really been impressive.
Well, I think he's impressive because he blew off Schmidtke of the Federal Republic of Germany, who is the kilometer champion this year. And everybody thought, well, Schmidtke might double, win that in the match sprint, but Vernet upset him. All right, the bell lapped, and this is where it will happen.
Now you can see Nelson starting to wind it up, make sure the speed is fast so if that French rider gets a jump. It's not going to be that strong of a jump. The French rider's taking him. Look at that, high on the track.
Look out here because they would like to slingshot in behind.
Woo!
Vernet will go high here on the outside, and Bales is fighting him off.
Bales is on the pole lane.
And Bales pedals hard. He's going to win it.
Whoa.
Oh, he came right up and looked him in the eye, and Bales said, see you around.
French rider tried to come inside on Nelson. Nelson was on the pole lane. Here you can see it. Here we can see it in slow motion. You can see Nelson in between the red and the black line. The French rider tries to come up inside on him. Nelson just cuts him off. That's all legal. French rider backs off. Nelson continues on to that finish line.
Fine time, 10.93 from the 200-meter mark on in. That's the best time we have had recorded here. And he beats him across, but oh, that is so important to win this first heat, because it doesn't put you down psychologically. You don't, you know, you've got a little buffer in there because of the two out of three. All Nelson Vales has to do is win one more, and he goes to the finals. What a story that would be for this former messenger from New York City, and he says, yeah, number one, well, we'll see. Back with more cycling from the Velodrome.